good to see everybody. Happy New Year. Glad that you're all here to hear together today at our Fayetteville campus. All those of you watching via video at Pinnacle, we're glad to have you up there as well. We'd like to join together in our first service together right here. And thanks everybody here at Fayetteville. Specifically, let me speak to Fayetteville campus. It's packed in here today, and I know we have overflow today. I apologize that you're out there. I know the parking was even a little crazy today. Next week, we go back to three services here at Fayetteville campus, 8 o'clock. I know all y'all gonna be there. That's right, okay, that's good. So everybody here at the 9:30 will transition to the 8 o'clock. Then we'll have a new crew of people at 9:30 and then 11 o'clock. So that's a good deal. So we look forward to kicking that off next Sunday. We had an outstanding Christmas season. I don't know if you went to the Christmas Eve services or Christmas Day services, but really it was a special, special time. We shared the gospel with thousands of people. And here's the cool thing. We had over 40 people text in that they had made a profession of faith in Christ. Isn't that awesome? Let's praise the Lord together on that. That is awesome. So we've had a great Christmas season. Hope you got to catch your breath a little bit over the holidays. And now we are about a week into 21 days of prayer. If you are new to our church, or maybe you've just been out for a few weeks and you're like, dude, I didn't even know we had a prayer emphasis right now. Every January, we begin the year with 21 days of intentional prayer. And I would encourage you to just jump on board with us. Last week, for the first week of 21 days, we said, hey, what's your biggest burden in your personal life that you want to pray about your own life? Today, we kind of begin to transition to a week of prayer about our families. So what's the biggest burden in your family right now? Is it a strained relationship? Maybe it's a wayward son or grandson, granddaughter, daughter, something like that. Maybe it's tension with your parents. Not that that ever happens, right? But, you know, it could be a host of things. Maybe it's an illness or diagnosis that somebody in your family's received. In other words, just take this week to intentionally pray that God would do something special in your family. And next week, starting next Saturday, Sunday, whenever you want to do it, we're going to challenge you to fast from food for 7 days. You say, what'd you say? We're going to encourage you to fast from food for 7 full days. Now, some of you have never fasted for a meal, much less a day or a week. But I want to encourage you to take up the biblical practice of fasting for the last 7 days of this journey together as a church. I promise you, God speaks to you in a way that is just different. And so I want to encourage you to think about that. And you may need to consult your doctor, especially if you're on medication. Maybe you'd say, Nick, I can't do that because of what I have health-wise. Well, I would encourage you to find something else to fast from for that 7 days. And let's really finish strong starting next weekend together. Sound good, everybody? All right, who's in for the fast? All right, let's go. All right, see you there. And at the 8 o'clock, right? Okay. Well, let's grab our Bibles. 1 John chapter 2 is where we're going to be. We're going to begin a brand new series that will carry us through the next 3 Sundays, really the remainder of 21 days of prayer, that we're calling enemies of the soul. Enemies of the soul. Whether you realize it or not, you have some enemies that do not want your soul to be where God wants it to be. And really, in light of 21 days, really 21 days of prayer is all about getting back to where you need to be with God. It's easy as you finish the year and as you have the stress of the holidays and so much that pulls upon you, it's very easy to just kind of get a little off track spiritually. Well, 21 days of prayer is kind of like a snap back into reality for every single one of us. And so, again, whether you knew we were in the midst of this or not, whether you did anything the first week or not, I would encourage you to jump in even right now here today finish this journey with us over the next couple weeks, all right? Last year, I read a book called Live No Lies by John Mark Comer. You'll see the book cover behind me. It greatly impacted me. Now, John Mark Comer is a pastor in the Pacific Northwest, and so he writes from a very different perspective than Northwest Arkansas. Okay, you can imagine that. But he speaks with biblical preciseness about the world, the flesh, and the devil. That's what we're going to talk about the next 3 weeks, the world, the flesh, and the devil. You're going to hear me and our other preachers quote from this book over the next couple weeks, because it was really as I read this book last year that God birthed something in my heart. And I knew as I read it that, okay, somehow this is going to come back to the church. I knew that some of the principles that I learned personally would be so helpful to you. So this This is where this all comes from, okay? So over the next 3 weeks, we're going to talk about those three enemies of the soul, the world, the flesh, the devil. Let me quote from Comer here as we get started. He says this. He says, here's my working theory. As followers of Jesus, we are at war with the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the enemy's stratagem is as follows. Deceptive ideas, that's the devil, that play to disordered desires, that's the flesh. And ultimately, they're normalized in a sinful society, which is the world. So it's pretty helpful the way that he lays it out here as he covers those three things. We're going to do the same thing. We're going to do these in reverse order than what he says. We're going to go the world first, then the flesh next week, then the devil, the final week of 21 days of prayer. But I think that's a helpful way to look at it as we get started here today and as we get jumping, as we jump right in here to 1 John chapter 2. So if you got your Bible open, let's look at verses 15 through 17. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to read all three verses. Today, I'm only going to cover really verses 15 and 17. It's like the outside of an Oreo. And then next week, it only gets better, right? We're going to cover the middle, verse 16, all right? And so let's look at this together. Here's what the Bible says. If you don't have a Bible, we'll throw these up here on the screen for you. John says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. Verse 17, and the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. Okay, so right off the bat, as you hear those three verses, let me clarify what I mean when I'm talking about the world. Because you may hear me say that one of the enemies of your soul is the world, and you're thinking like John 3:16, that Jesus gave his life for the world. And you're like, hold up, that does not coincide together. It doesn't make sense. Let me help define what the world actually means. So I'm going to take you back to middle school. Remember when you and that girl were kind of like sending notes across the desk from one another, and eventually you had to have the DTR, the define the relationship talk of like, what are we? Are we just friends? Are we just people who DM together? I'm just speaking in modern day terms here. Do we just text together? What are we? Okay, well, let me help define the terms of the Bible today, all right? So let me define the term when I use the world. What are we speaking about? Well, let's go to Jesus first of all, okay? Jesus defined the world in a few different ways in his own sayings in the Bible. Number one, think about this. He says, what does it matter if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? He goes on another passage. He says, the world hated me and it will hate you also. Makes a lot of sense as we think about our modern day culture, does it not? And then he finally says, I am not of the world, but was sent into the world and now am sending you into the world. So Jesus right there speaks about it in two or three different definitions right there of how he writes about the world. In the book, Comer gives a few different definitions from different people, and then his own. He quotes Dallas Willard. Dallas Willard says this. He says, it's our cultural and social practices that are under the control of Satan and thus opposed to God. Jerry Brashears defines it this way. The world is Satan's domain where his authority and values reign, though his deception makes that hard to realize. That's a key statement right there. So Satan reigns in the world, and yet his deception, which we'll talk about week three, makes it hard for us to realize that we're actually being deceived. And if you are of the world, he says, then it all sounds right. That's why you have such a culture that accepts the things of the devil, okay? Finally, Comer gives his own definition. I think this is the best. He says, the world is what happens when a bunch of people give in to their flesh and base animalistic desires are normalized. It is a system of ideas, values, morals, practices, and social norms that are integrated into the mainstream and eventually institutionalized in a culture corrupted by the sins of rebellion against God and the redefinition of good and evil. It's really powerful. And you think about that last little statement right there, why is the world the way that it is today? So why is American culture the way that it is right here in January of 2023? It's because of those twin sins, rebellion against God and the redefinition of good and evil. Man, we are seeing this to a T right here. So a little more clear what the Bible means when it says the world. By hearing all of that, it's speaking about the mindset, the ideology of what Satan has done in this life. Okay, so with that in mind, let's go back to the passage. Okay, let's go back to verse 15. Let's go back through it again. He says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So really two phrases, okay? Number one is really a challenge and a command. Do not love the world. In other words, do not let your affections go to the systems and the realm of what we currently live in. Do not buy into all that you hear on the news or on social media or at your office or at your school. That's what he's saying right here. Do not love the world. In other words, do not let your loyalty shift from God to the world. The second phrase is not really a command or a challenge. It's more of a revealer, all right? And here's what it reveals. If you do love the world, again, not the people of the world. Are we to love the people of the world? Yes or no? All right, that's good. I was just kind of giving you a little hint with a nod right there, all right? We are to love the people of the world. But we are not to love the world. And the Bible here is saying, if you do love the world, it is a revealer that the love of God is not in you. Now, let's talk both of these things. By the way, this is a heavy passage today. I was reading through my notes yesterday, thinking, okay, this is going to be a heavy one today. Let's go back through these phrases here. Do not love the world or the things in the world. Let me give you an example of this, okay? I'll call this the world's systems on display, all right? The world's systems on display. We could talk about 1,000 different things right now related to the world's systems being on display or the world and the ideology of the world. Let me just speak about two that are on the news every day that are the cultural things of our moment, okay? Let me give you two. First one is this, the distortion of sexuality, gender, and marriage. The distortion, sexuality, gender, and marriage. Now, this is probably the number one way that we see the world's systems on display. How so? The world fights against sexuality being solely expressed in a man and a woman within marriage. We have everything but that being practiced, right? The world fights against the idea of two distinct genders, gender not being fluid. By the way, if you want to hear more about that, we talked in depth about that in our series in November, December. I think we spoke on that on November 20th, if I'm not mistaken. You can go back online and watch that. And then the world fights against the idea of marriage only between a man and a woman, not two men, not two women. So the world's ideology is on display in the distortion of all of those things that I just discussed, okay? Now, let me be real clear, all right? This is a message of clarity, all right? People who fight against what God says in those specific things, it is evidence that they really do not know Jesus personally as Savior. All right? So in other words, if somebody fights against what God has said clearly in His Word and says, no, I think it's okay for this or this or this to take place, whatever cultural phenomenon of the day that it is, but it's opposed to the Word of God. Here's what John is saying in 1 John 2. It's just evidence that they really have never been saved. That's what it's saying very clearly, okay? So the distortion of those things. Let me talk about a second thing, and this one happens in a multitude of ways as well, just the devaluing of human life. The devaluing of human life. We could talk about children in the womb all the way to people who are old and about to die, okay? We see the devaluing of life through violence. We see it through murder. We have those issues in our own country. We see this in abuse of all kinds. We see this in racism. Like, you name it, all the ways that we devalue another human life. It is a culture that devalues life. Let me give you an example, okay? You may have heard about this or not. Think about the unborn, okay? Let's talk about a vote that was up for debate in Montana in November. It was called the Montana Referendum Number 131, And here's what it was about. It required medical care to be provided to infants who are born alive, including after an attempted abortion. So in other words, a baby has been born even after a botched abortion and the baby is alive. Do we require the doctor to step in and take care of the baby or do we not? 52.4% voted against providing medical care for an infant. 47% voted in favor of that. Can I just pause and let's think about the gravity of that moment? And I just use that as an example of what we're talking about today. And can we all just agree, like, what in the world is going on in the world that we would not require that, okay? Now, think about these issues. Again, I said earlier, I could mention 1,000 different issues that we could talk about. Those are two that are hot topics all the time, okay? And all these have come as a result of what we would call as the modern moral revolution. Author Theo Hobson writes about the three marks of the modern moral revolution, and they relate so well with 1 John chapter 2. Here's what Theo Hobson says. He says, what was universally condemned is now celebrated. What was universally celebrated is now condemned. Those who refuse to celebrate are condemned. Hello. It's right where we live. Is that not true, Fayetteville? That not true, Pinnacle Hills? Like, this is right where we live today, okay? Let's go to the next statement. He says, if anyone loves the world, when you look at this in the Greek language, the Greek tense could be translated, if anyone keeps on loving the world. So it's like a progressive thing in your life that you never have a moment where you stop loving the world, but you just keep on, keep on, keep on, keep on. In other words, we all begin our lives not saved, okay? There's not one person who has been born a Christian, all right? That's just not how it works, okay? You must be born again. I read that in my Bible reading this morning, that John chapter 3. You must be born again spiritually, okay? So in other words, all of us are born sinners. We all have a sin nature. So in other words, we are all of the world when we are born. In other words, the world's ways, they sound right. They seem right to us. And listen to me, then you come to faith in Christ. And we have people on both ends of that spectrum here at both of these campuses today. There are some of you in the room today. You could point me to a time. You say, Nick, at this moment, I gave my life to Christ. It was 26 years ago. It was 23 days ago. I gave my life to Christ. And here's what one of the major, 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 major shifts that takes place. The more you grow in your faith with the Lord is that your loyalty and your mindset begins to shift. From how you've thought your entire life to what you've been taught your entire life to things that your family has held dear for your entire life. And then you come to faith in Christ and just very slowly and subtly God begins to change you. And he begins to shift your mindset and to shift your loyalty on all kinds of things. Can I be honest with you about my own life? My mind has changed on a lot of subjects over the years. You say, well, how, are you not firm in your beliefs? No, I'm very firm in my beliefs. I just had some beliefs that were wrong. And the more that I have been sanctified, been changed into the likeness of Jesus after I got saved, and the more I understand of the Word of God, the more my mind changes. And the more my loyalty shifts from who I used to be to who I need to be. Does that make sense? And let me say it to you this way, just a step further. And that's the way it should be in your life if you're a Christian. Like, you should be able to look back 10 years ago and and think to yourself, golly, man, I had some jacked up beliefs back then. Or I was just off. Or I was just really selfish. Or I was really bought into the world. Or listen, as I've grown in my understanding of the Word of God, as Jesus has just continued to change me, man, I am such a different person than I was all those years ago. The Bible continues. He says, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Think about James and how he says it. James is the brother of Jesus. He says, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? So those are strong words from James and John, two of Jesus' closest followers. that to be a friend of a system opposed to God means that you are living with hatred and animosity towards God. Again, can we all agree? Heavy message, heavy passage. I mean, this is a wake-up call to some of us in the room today who you really need to examine if you're a follower of Christ or not. And to be honest with you, this is a wake-up call to believers in the rooms about what are you actually believing. I could say it to you this way, okay? As I was studying this passage and preparing this message, I almost preached something different to you on this exact point as I was working through the message. I almost said this to you. I didn't say it. I almost said it, all right? Got the difference? I was about to say this to you, okay? That a person who loves the world and the things in the world is either one of two things. They're either a wayward, off-track believer, or they are a lost person, a person who's never come to faith in Christ. I almost taught that to you, all right? As I continue to study the passage, I think what the Bible is teaching us here is actually way more black and white than that. Here's what the Bible is teaching. If you love God and not the world, you're a Christian. If you love the world and its system of operations, you are not a Christian. Like, that's the plain teaching of 1 John chapter 2. And so it's not either or. It's that. Okay? And so if you love God and not the world, the Bible says, listen, you're a Christian. And the flip side of that, if you love the world and the system of the world and you don't love God, guess what? You are not a Christian. Doesn't matter if you were born into a Christian home or not. Okay? Someone who is dominated by the world, loves the world, lives in the world. It is a sign. It is evidence they've never truly come to faith in Christ. Now, here's the interesting thing about 1 John chapter 2. I say all of that, and then I say this. Who is John writing to? Believers or unbelievers? Believers. So that's an interesting thing for us to deal with now, right? He's being very clear, like, draw the line. You love God, not the world. You're a Christian. You love the world, not God. You're not a Christian. But he's writing to Christians. So what are we to do about that, okay? Let me help explain that. When he tells believers not to love the world or the things in the world, I do think he is alluding here that there is a temptation for every Christian in this room, every Christian in the room at Pinnacle and in Overflow today, a temptation for you to fall away from certain beliefs, a temptation for you to be deceived by the world. And he's saying, listen, do not be deceived by those things. So is there a possibility that a Christian could be persuaded by certain beliefs in the world and kind of fudge on those or kind of get off track in those? I think the answer is absolutely that is true, and I think that's why John is writing this. So let me try to bring clarity in the midst of all that, okay? What kind of person are we speaking about here? Think of somebody with a habitual lifestyle of buying into the world versus a person who occasionally falls into sin. That's how you know and kind of a test of evidence of who's a Christian and who's not a Christian. So somebody who's habitually in the lifestyle of the world, who is buying into the thoughts of the world, who is hook, line, and sinker on all that the world is selling, versus a person who is a Christian and is just kind of on shaky ground, trying to grow in their faith, trying to understand what the Bible teaches, and all that is really important to understand, okay? So let me be clear, because sometimes we have parents and grandparents in here who you raise your kids in church, and at some point they prayed a prayer, they walked an aisle, and yet they never showed a heart for God. They never moved forward in any sense of their faith. Now they are totally in the world, have no heart for God, no love for God. I believe the Bible would give you evidence that your child, grandchild, they really don't know Jesus. Again, I'm just being like gut level honest with what the Word would say on these things. You contrast that with a person. Let's say there's a person in these rooms today. Maybe you got saved 3 months ago. And man, it was a dramatic transformation. You were all in the world, the belief systems of the world, ideologies of the world, the sin of the world, and now you've come to faith in Christ. And you look at your friends, and all of their beliefs are like over here now, because they've been following Christ for a while, and yet you're over here and you're struggling through, well, what about this thing? And how am I supposed to view that? And how am I supposed to act in that way? And you're kind of working through all that's a totally different situation than what I'm talking about today, a situation that I'm talking about. That's a person who is newly saved, who is working out their salvation, who is beginning to be sanctified, who is understanding what the Word of God is actually teaching and how they need to live their life. You see the two differences in those kind of people? Vastly different situations here, okay? Listen to me loud and clear, all right? I'll be real, like, try to be real practical with you. Anybody feel the pressure of the world out there right now? Feel it at school? At your job with the corporate world? You got tension with your family and friends who are in a totally different mindset and life than you are? And you just had a really awkward Christmas where discussions came up around the table that you're like, bro, are we doing this right now? It's Christmas Eve. Turkey's hot. Are we really going to do this right now? And you're just trying to be a godly person, but you feel the tension, right? You got the tension, the pressure of all that the world is selling, and yet you're trying to follow Christ, and you're being, you know, just belted left and right from all that Satan is doing. And here's what I tell you. This is let me pastor you this morning. Here, Pinnacle Overflow. The application for 1 John chapter 2 in your own life. Again, speaking to those of you who would call yourself a Christian, the application of this passage is to beware of the world's influence upon your life. Just beware. Because if you are consumed with the things of the world, guess what? Eventually, it will begin to have an impact on you. It's like your parents would tell you, you roll your eyes as a teenager, they'd say, garbage in, garbage out. You'd roll your eyes, that's so stupid, Mom. Doesn't happen to me. I'm the exception in the universe. Like, it clicked. Well, in some ways, that's the message of 1 John chapter 2. Speaking to believers, saying, do not love the world or the things in the world. And why would he tell us that? Because it is a system opposed to God. That's what it is. And so some of you some of you have been a believer for a long time. You say, Nick, I'm firm in my faith. Man, I've walked through sanctification for many years now. I know the Word of God. But golly, man, the pressure I'm under. The pressure I'm under at my job. To celebrate things, to endorse things, or I got pressure within my own family, and I don't know how to answer all their questions, and I'm not able to explain this all the way. You're feeling the weight of the pressure, and you got to hold strong. There are others of you who you're a fairly new believer. Let me say that you've met Christ in the last 5 to 10 years. So still very much so the Word of God is new to you, and what the Word of God is teaching is very new to you. And so you're trying to make sense of deeply held beliefs that you've had your entire life, but now realize they're a part of a system opposed to God. And you're sitting there thinking to yourself, well, man, what am I supposed to do with that? And if I do this, this is what it will cost me. And if I do this, it'll hurt this relationship. And if I do this, it's going to affect me in this way in my job. And if I do, I mean, that's every single person in here, by the way. And my encouragement to you is the same. You got to hold strong to what the Word of God says. You got to hold strong. You say, well, Nick, I just want to be a loving person. the most loving thing that you can do is to tell people what the Bible says. Are we living for this world or the next? That's the question. If we're living just for this world, okay, well, that's a totally different conversation. But we know that's not all there is. And so we look ahead to eternity. We're about to go there as we wrap up. We look ahead and we find our loving nature by pointing to what is one day going to happen. Warning people, admonishing people, encouraging people to put their faith in Christ and to sell out to him in every area of their life. That is the most loving thing that you could ever do. Now, let's wrap up with verse 17, okay? This will kind of bring a full measure, full scope of what we've talked about today. This points to eternity, by the way. He says, and the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. So why do we not need to love the world? Here's the number one answer. Because it's temporary. Like, it's all passing away. It will end when Christ returns. He will make all that is wrong in the world right. When I say a phrase like that, we often think about just the personal aspect of that. That's right. He's going to vindicate. He will save us once and for all. He will put an end to wrong. He'll wipe every tear away from my eye. Like we think of the personal aspect of that. Can I give you the big world side of that? Jesus will put an end to the world systems. He will deal once and for all with sin, and he will bring justice upon evil of all kinds. That's what the Bible says. So why do we not love the world? Why do we not encourage people to buy into the world? Why are you not to buy into the world systems? Man, it's all passing away. We live for another world. We live for heaven, not for earth. Think about the opposite of that. But whoever does God's will lives forever. It's again just pointing to evidence here. Just how he said, listen, if you love the world, you're not a Christian. Well, it's evidence that you're not a Christian. On the flip side of this, now he says it this way. If you do the will of God, if you do what God says to do, if you hold to what God says to hold, he says, it's an evidence that you're a Christian. It's a sign. It's pointing to the fact that you are saved. You'll live forever with God in heaven. Let me just pause there and ask this question. Do you have that confidence in your own life? Do you have confidence that if you were to die today, that you would experience the reality of that verse? People often talk about these big cultural issues. They say, well, you need to be on the right side of history. Right side of history. And what is that? It's a pressure to accept, to buy into, to behold the things that the world loves. Can I encourage us from 1 John chapter 2? Let's be on the right side of eternity. Be on the right side of eternity. I mean, think about the horror of what your friends who don't know Christ, who if you were to just buy into the world systems, never confront them with the gospel in love, never talk about how Jesus provides a better way, never talk about sin. Can you imagine your best friend, your family member, whoever it is, as they make their way to hell? And I don't know that this will happen. I don't think we have biblical evidence this will happen, but it'd be interesting if they were to turn around and say to you, so you didn't share with me because you were afraid? So you didn't hold firm to what you really believed the truth because you just wanted to be nice to me? This isn't nice. That's what it means to live for eternity. That we're looking forward to another day and we view all of our lives through that lens. Let me apply this as we wrap up and we'll be done, okay? No doubt, every one of us in here, we know somebody who has been deceived by the world. Isn't that true? You know people in your life? They bought in all that the world is selling right now. The application for 1 John chapter 2 is, man, let's lift that person up in prayer today, even as we wrap up this service. 21 days of prayer is obviously kind of a personal walk with the Lord, a personal journey with God. Here's what I would encourage you with. Why don't you ask the Lord to reveal any areas of your own life that you've been deceived? Are there areas of your own life that you're buying into? Maybe it's around sexuality, marriage, or gender. Maybe it's around how you raise your kids. That if I don't have my kid on that 5-year-old baseball team, he's never going to make it to the big leagues. So we're going to abandon church for 6 months so we can do... Maybe it's around money, the way that the world says you got to spend your money. It could be a host of things. So I just pray, Lord, is there any way in my own life that I have bought into the world systems, that I have been deceived? Lord, would you bring truth into my heart? It's a great phrase to pray to God. Would you reveal truth? Finally, I just want to ask you a question, because this is a heavy message. It's like a blunt message. All agree it's a blunt day. Blunt Sunday at Cross Church. Here we are. Are you really a Christian? Well, Nick, I was raised in church. It's not what I asked. I was baptized as a child. It's not what I asked. Do you love God and not the world? It's evidence you're a Christian. Are you consumed with the world and the things of the world, ideologies of the world, and not God? It's a sign probably you've never met Jesus Christ. And today, here's the amazing thing. And I was driving here, and I had worship going on. You know what? You know how you do it on the way to church, like getting fired up. And man, just overwhelmed again with the gospel of Jesus Christ. That God would save somebody like me. That God can save somebody like you. Who is an enemy of God. Live for yourself. Live for sin. And God in his grace sent his only son Jesus Christ to come. To die on the cross for our sins. So that if you would ever hear the gospel. You would ever hear what we're talking about today. And say, you know what? I'm wrong. I am wrong. That's where salvation begins, by the way. I am wrong. I am not right. Something is broken, and that's me. And I'm ready to turn away from a life, live for myself, turn away from a life, live for sin. And I'm ready to put my faith, not in a vague higher power, I'm ready to put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross in my place, that I could be saved and forgiven of my sin. It's the most amazing thing you could ever hear right there. I'm just reminded afresh of it here on January 8th. Amen. If you've never experienced the gospel of Jesus Christ, if you've never been saved, maybe this passage has opened your eyes to the religious game you've been playing, but you've never really been changed by the Lord. Would you allow him to change you right now? Let's bow our head and close our eyes right now. I didn't plan to do this. I just feel led in the moment. I'm going to do this a little bit different. But here at Pinnacle Hills, if you're in overflow, this applies to you as well. In a moment, we're going to give you an opportunity to come and talk to somebody. But before we even do that, I want to speak directly to you. If you know that you need Jesus Christ, like you just know that. Today's passage has just illuminated your soul. Like, man, I know that I've been living a game, and I need the Lord to save me today. I'm just going to invite you to just pray directly to God. You're not praying to me. But if you're ready to turn your life over to Christ and be saved, you recognize the weight and the guilt and the shame of your sin, and you would say, man, I need Christ to forgive me and change me today. Right where you're at, wherever you're located, just utter these words in your heart. The Lord can hear it. Just say, dear Jesus, today I give my life to you. I willingly turn from myself, my sin and the world, and I put my faith in you, Jesus. Would you forgive me of my sin today? And would you change me completely? While our heads are still bowed, all across these rooms, whether you're here in this room at Fayetteville, out in the lobby today, maybe you're at Pinnacle Hills. If that was you and you just say, Nick, I just prayed to receive Christ, I put my faith in the Lord today, would you just raise your hand? Nobody looking but me. Nick, that was me today. Praise God, ma'am. Anybody else? Yeah, praise the Lord, sir. Anybody else? Raise it high so I can see it. Yeah, praise the Lord. Yeah. Adults giving their lives to Jesus today. Anybody else? How about you at Pinnacle? You raise it high. How about you in the lobby? Sitting in an overflow. God saved you today. Here's how we're going to wrap up. Our staff's going to make our way to the front right now, both here and at Pinnacle Hills. If you just raise your hand, I'm going to invite you. When we stand and sing in just a moment, I'm asking you to make a very bold step. Bold, bold step. But you're in a room of people who have done exactly what you've just done, who are going to celebrate with you, who will love you, and they'll be helpful to you. You just say, excuse me, you can get out in the aisle. I want to invite you to come to one of the men or the women who are standing up here, and all you got to say is, hey, I just prayed with Nick, just gave my life to Christ. They'll take it from there, answer any questions that you have. So you come wherever you're at. Fayetteville team, let's make sure somebody is in the lobby. One of our staff will be out there. They'll wave at you. You just go to them, okay? We're going to wrap up our service with one final song. As soon as we do, would you respond? You come forward. Maybe you're here today, and God's just touched your heart about something in the message, something in your own life. You just want to lay at the altar before the Lord in prayer. You come here. You come to the room at Pinnacle, and you just lay that there at the altar, okay? Lord, we love you. We thank you for new life today in Christ. Pray that you would help this passage to go deep, deep, deep into our souls. It's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen.